A very good morning to you guys. So in this session we are going to discuss some information which you will find useful if you are preparing for any competitive exam, and due to network issues we couldn't have a live session for this day, day 88, and that is why we are putting up a recorded session. Hope it helps you in your preparation and in understanding the concepts that affect our economy, right? So as you all know, my name is Mansi Anand, your mentor for RBI Grade B examination. So let's not waste any time and move straight away to question number one. And before moving to question number one, I would like to ask you guys to subscribe to our channel and don't forget to hit this bell icon which is flashing on the screen. It can help you to stay in touch with us and get updated regarding every notification that comes up, right? So moving ahead to question number one. So guys, here is your question number one for today, which says select the correct statement. So here five statements are given to you which are somehow based on globalizations and its effect on inflations in the country, right? So you have to select the correct statement out of these and then we'll discuss the reasons behind it, right? So the correct option for this question is option D, that globalization is deflationary and its reversal is going to be inflationary. So this is the correct option. Now let us understand how D is the correct option. So guys, first of all, globalization leads to so many changes in the economies, right? So the purpose of globalization is to get best goods or produce them in a place, in a location where they can be produced cheaply and then transfer them to rest of the world. So globalization ka major purpose kya hai? Ki aap goods ko aisi jagah pe produce karo jahan pe wo sabse zyada cheap tarike se, sabse saste mein produce ho sakte hain, uske baad use puri duniya mein transfer kar dijiye. So that the entire world can have a benefit of cheaper goods, taki sari duniya in saste goods ka benefit le sake, right? तो जैसे जैसे इंडिया ने भी ग्लोबलाइज किया, इंडिया का ट्रेड बढ़ा बाकी कंट्रीज़ के साथ, आप देख सकते हो कि कैसे हमारे पास ज़्यादा रेंज के प्रोडक्ट्स आने लगे फ्रॉम ऑल ओवर द वर्ल्ड, राइट? एंड चाइना तो ऑलरेडी इज़ फेमस फॉर प्रोड्यूसिंग लो कॉस्ट गुड्स एंड देन ट्रांसफरिंग इट टू डिफरेंट कंट्रीज, राइट? ओके, सो लेट अस नाउ स्टडी द रीजंस. फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल, ड्यू टू ग्लोबलाइजेशन इट इज़ पॉसिबल टू ट्रांसफर गुड्स. Mobility is very high from a location where they can be produced at cheapest to a location where it is expensive to produce them. So I just told you that if China can manufacture goods at lowest cost, then due to globalization it is easy for China to transfer those goods all over the world so that they can have benefit of cheaper products. So in other countries it might not be feasible to produce those goods at such a lower cost. So China अगर सस्ता माल बना सकता है तो globalization की वजह से ही वो उसे पूरी दुनिया में spread कर पाता है. हो सकता है बाकी countries में इतना cheap ना हो manufacturing करना या goods को बनाना इतना सस्ता ना हो. After that it promotes intense competition between firms to snatch a larger share of market. Competition not only exists within the boundary but all across the globe. And firms try to cut their prices so as to match with that of their rival. Ab now what happens is, due to globalization there is intense competition among different firms belonging to different countries, right? So when a local industry has to compete with the best around the world, they anyhow have to produce efficiently and they have to cut their prices in order to match the best of the world, right? So this competition, it promotes firms or it lets the firm cut prices so that they can compete with their rivals. So जैसे ही competition बढ़ता है globalization की वजह से, क्योंकि एक छोटी firm जो है, जो एक particular area में काम कर रही है, let's say India के किसी local industry की बात की जाए, अगर globalization है और उसे foreign firm से भी competition आ रहा है, तो obviously it will have to match its prices to that competition, right? सो ये जब कंपटीशन बहुत ज़्यादा बढ़ जाता है तो फर्म्स प्राइसेस कट करती हैं ताकि वो एक दूसरे से मार्केट शेयर छीन सकें. आफ्टर दैट, टू स्टे इन मार्केट फर्म्स हैव टू बी एफिशिएंट, विच दे कैन डू सो विथ क्रिएटिव डिसरप्शन. क्रिएटिव डिसरप्शन For providing goods at cheaper cost, they have to continuously innovate, and when the competition is with the best of the world, improving is must, which helps to cut cost and reduction in prices. Now, globalization also promotes efficiency, right? First of all, globalization allows countries to make those products or manufacture those goods and services at which they are best, right? So they can the raw materials are available easily, the labor is cheap, so they can so whatever goods a country can manufacture cheaply, that is manufactured by them and then sent to the rest of the world due to globalization. And now when they do it, they have to do it efficiently because there is a lot of competition. So globalization leads to increase in efficiency, and firms continuously have to innovate. So firms ko kuch na kuch naya leke aana hota hai. They have to bring new every time, or they have to change their processes in order to increase efficiency, or they have to get a hold of new technology so that they can produce at a much faster and efficient rate. So efficiency is must, and this efficiency allows the producer to cut cost and hence cut prices. Right? After that, one more very important point, that globalization leads to reduction of trade barriers. When the countries are in a mood to trade a lot with each other, they want globalization to spread, they try to reduce the trade barriers amongst them so that the importers and exporters have no problem in transferring their goods. Right? जब भी कंट्रीज चाहती हैं कि हम ग्लोबलाइज करें, दूसरी कंपनीज के साथ ज़्यादा से ज़्यादा, दूसरी कंट्रीज के साथ ज़्यादा से ज़्यादा ट्रेड करें, उस सिचुएशन में उन्हें क्या करना होता है, उस सिचुएशन में वो जितने भी ट्रेड बैरियर्स हैं, जो भी टैक्सेस लगते हैं, कस्टम ड्यूटी लगती है, कोटास लगते हैं, उन्हें कम से कम रखने की कोशिश करते हैं, ट्रेड बैरियर्स को कम से कम रखने की कोशिश करते हैं, और उसकी वजह से भी प्राइस जो है इम्पोर्टेड प्रोडक्ट्स का वो कम हो जाता है. अब आप देख लीजिए, अगर कोई प्रोडक्ट चाइना से आता है, इफ़ वी आर प्रोड्यूसिंग एनी प्रोडक्ट, इफ़ वी आर इम्पोर्टिंग एनी प्रोडक्ट फ्रॉम चाइना एंड देर इज़ अ ह्यूज टैरिफ ऑन इट, देन दैट प्रोडक्ट इज गोइंग टू बी एक्सपेंसिव. और अगर उस पर बहुत ज़्यादा टैरिफ है तो वो एक्सपेंसिव हो जाएगा इंडिया में, बट अगर उस टैरिफ को रिड्यूस कर दिया जाए, देन इट्स गोइंग टू बी चीपर, राइट? सो उसी तरीके से ट्रेड बैरियर्स जब कम होते हैं ग्लोबलाइजेशन की वजह से, तो प्रोडक्ट्स का ट्रांसफर जो है वो चीपर हो जाता है, एंड ग्लोबलाइजेशन लीड्स टू रिडक्शन इन ट्रेड बैरियर्स एंड इंक्रीज इन ईज ऑफ ट्रांसफरिंग द गुड्स फ्रॉम वन प्लेस टू अनदर. Right? So these are the reasons that tell us why globalization is deflationary. It leads to reduction in prices of products. That is why the statement is correct, that globalization was deflationary. It has had a huge impact on the countries all over the world, and it has provided the consumers with a wider range of products at cheapest costs possible. And its reversal is going to be inflationary. Now guys, this was the trend when globalization was in the globalization was the trend. Now as you guys must have seen that recently we have seen that countries are moving back from globalization. They are adopting protectionism once again, and they are closing their economies, right? So every country now, most of the countries are on a spree to promote to manufacture or produce the goods within their own boundaries rather than importing them from other countries. So this protectionism is going to be inflationary, as it might not be very cheap for countries to produce each and every product within their boundaries, and it might lead to high prices. So you can see, aap dekh sakte ho ki kaise कंट्रीज़ के लिए हर प्रोडक्ट को अपनी बाउंड्रीज़ के अंदर ही प्रोड्यूस करना बहुत ज़्यादा चीप नहीं होता है. बट अभी जो ट्रेंड चल रहा है, आप देख सकते हैं कि सारी मोस्ट ऑफ द कंट्रीज़ जो हैं, उनका मूड जो है वो प्रोटेक्शनिज्म वाला है. दे वांट टू क्लोज देयर इकोनॉमीज़, वो किसी के साथ ज़्यादा ट्रेड नहीं करना चाह रहे दूसरी कंट्रीज़ के साथ, एंड दे वॉन्ट कि वो हर चीज़ अपने देश में ही प्रोड्यूस करके कंज्यूम कर ले और उन्हें इम्पोर्ट्स कम से कम करने पड़े. दैट इज़ नॉट गुड फॉर द वर्ल्ड ट्रेड और ग्लोबल ट्रेड. सो दिस इज़ अ ट्रेंड रिवर्स टू द ग्लोबलाइजेशन. ये ग्लोबलाइजेशन का उल्टा ट्रेंड है कि कंट्रीज वापस प्रोटेक्शनिज्म की तरफ जा रही हैं, राइट? सो सो दिस इज़ गोइंग टू बी इन्फ्लेशनरी. अब आप देख सकते हो जैसे इंडिया में भी अभी काफ़ी एंटी चाइना सेंटिमेंट है एंड एवरी वन इज सेइंग के वी आर नॉट गोइंग टू इम्पोर्ट एनी गुड्स फ्रॉम चाइना, वी आर गोइंग टू बी सेल्फ रिलायंट. बट द पॉइंट इज कैन वी प्रोड्यूस द गुड्स एट सच प्राइजेज एट विच चाइना प्रोवाइड्स अस टू देम, राइट, प्रोवाइड्स देम टू अस, राइट. सो ये देखना बहुत ज़रूरी है कि हम इस एंटी चाइना सेंटीमेंट के अंदर क्या गुड्स को उतने ही प्राइस पे प्रोड्यूस कर सकते हैं जितने पे चाइना हमें अब तक प्रोवाइड करवाता आया है या नहीं, राइट. सो मूविंग अहेड टू द नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन फॉर टुडे एंड दिस क्वेश्चन सेज, अकॉर्डिंग टू न्यू सेबी नॉर्म्स ब्रॉट ऑन July 3, अ नॉन इंडिविजुअल फाइनेंशियल एडवाइजर कैन प्रोवाइड बोथ एडवाइजरी एंड डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन सर्विसेज थ्रू अ सेपरेट आइडेंटिफाइएबल डिपार्टमेंट एंड डिविजन, but there should be dash between both the activities. So these are some new recent SEBI norms that SEBI has given regarding advisory and distribution services for investment. Financial advisor, who is a financial advisor who advises the clients that in what investment they should put their money, wo apna paisa kahan dale, kahan invest kare, kahan se unhe maximum profit, maximum returns mil sakte hain, right. So let us move ahead to the correct option for this question, and the correct option is option B, that is arm's length distance relationship. Guys, now to understand this point, let us try to understand these new norms, then we can easily understand this point. Okay, first of all, SEBI said that an individual has the option to either register as an investment advisor or provide distribution services as a distributor. अब SEBI क्या बोल रहा है कि या जितने भी financial advisors हैं वो या तो सिर्फ advising का काम करेंगे, सिर्फ अपने client को opinions देंगे और advice देंगे कि आप यहाँ अपना पैसा डालो, तो उनको उनकी counseling करेंगे, या फिर वो इन investment products को बेच सकते हैं. So either they can be advisor or they can be seller, they cannot be both at the same time. So ये एक आया है, ये जो norm आया है वो आया है individual फाइनेंशियल एडवाइजर के लिए. इंडिविजुअल मतलब अ पर्सन, नॉट एन एंटिटी और एन ऑर्गेनाइजेशन, बट अ पर्सन हु इज अ फाइनेंशियल एडवाइजर, एन इंडिविजुअल पर्सन, राइट. सो व्हाई डू यू थिंक SEBI वांट्स टू सेग्रीगेट एडवाइजरी एंड डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन सर्विसेज? देयर मस्ट बी सम रीजन व्हाई इट इज नॉट अलाउइंग अ सिंगल पर्सन टू डू बोथ द जॉब्स, काउंसलिंग एंड सेलिंग. सो द रीजन बिहाइंड दिस इज, when a person provides both of these performs both of these activities, there is a conflict of interest. And how is this so? Because a person advising the client to buy investment and simultaneously he is also selling the investment, he has an incentive to tell the client that please come and buy my own investment and it is going to provide you with good returns, whether or not that investment is suitable for the client, right. जब एक ही person दोनों काम करेगा तो आपको क्या लगता है, क्या वो advisor fair होके अपने client को advice दे पाएगा? नहीं, उसके पास incentive है कि वो अपना ही product बेचने की कोशिश करेगा. So let's say you go to a shop and you ask shopkeeper, let's say you want to buy a shirt and you go to an apparel shop and you tell the shopkeeper that I want to buy a shirt, tell me a good shop where I can get it. Obviously that shopkeeper is going to promote his or her own shop, right. आप किसी दुकान पे शर्ट खरीदने जाते हो और वहाँ पे जाके पूछते हो कि भैया यहाँ आसपास शर्ट कहाँ मिलेगी अच्छी सी, तो वो शॉपकीपर जो है वो आपको अपनी ही शर्ट बेचने की कोशिश करेगा, वो क्यों आपको कहीं और भेजेगा. हो सकता है आपको जैसी शर्ट चाहिए वो उसके पास ना मिले, बट स्टिल दैट शॉपकीपर वुड वॉन्ट टू एटलीस्ट शो यू दी वेराइटी और शो यू दी स्पेसिफिकेशंस ऑफ कैरेक्टर, स्पेसिफिकेशंस ऑफ द प्रोडक्ट्स ही हैज़, सो दैट ही कैन सेल देम टू यू. सो डू यू सी देयर इज अ कॉन्फ्लिक्ट ऑफ इंटरेस्ट इफ वन पर्सन डज बोथ ऑफ द एक्टिविटी परफॉर्म्स और डज बोथ ऑफ द जॉब्स, राइट. So a non-individual supplier, a non-individual advisor, now we are talking about an entity. Let's say there is an organization and it acts as a financial advisor to its client. So if there is a non-individual advisor, there is a company or there is an entity, it can provide both of these services. Ye dono cheeze provide kar sakti hain, advisory and distribution, but through a separate identifiable department and division. बट इसके लिए डिपार्टमेंट्स जो हैं वो टोटली अलग होने चाहिए ताकि एक डिपार्टमेंट से आने वाला बेनिफिट दूसरे को ना मिले, राइट? सो देयर इज अ कंपनी, देयर इज एन अम्ब्रेला कंपनी एंड लेट्स से दैट कंपनी हैज टू डिविजन्स, एडवाइजिंग क्लाइंट्स एंड सेलिंग ऑफ इन्वेस्टमेंट्स और डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन ऑफ investments. Now they should be totally separate and there should be an arm's length relationship between them. So what is meant by arm's length relationship? It means that if this advisor is providing any information or any advice to his client, and if he pitches this product sold by the selling department, that should not lead to any financial benefit to the advisor, right? So they should belong to different categories, different departments, and promoting the other one should never lead to a benefit for the advising department, right? So there should be an arm's length distance between both of the activities. What is meant by arm's length distance relationship? In business refers to a transaction where buyers and sellers act independently without influence of each other. They should not be able to influence each other. So humne kya baat kari ki agar ek umbrella organization hai, badi organization hai, and ek non-individual advisor hai, non-individual advisor matlab entity ya organization hai, to wo dono services provide kar sakta hai, but बशर्ते ये जो दोनों सर्विसेज है वो अलग अलग डिपार्टमेंट्स प्रोवाइड कर रहा हो, और एक अगर दूसरे को सजेस्ट कर रहा है तो उससे उसको कोई फाइनेंशियल बेनिफिट नहीं होना चाहिए, राइट? सो ताकि जो एडवाइज़र है वो अपना एक फेयर एडवाइस क्लाइंट को प्रोवाइड करा पाए. सो दीज स्टेप्स हैव बीन टेकन टू एनहांस ट्रांसपेरेंसी एंड प्रिवेंशन ऑफ क्रिएशन ऑफ कॉन्फ्लिक्ट ऑफ इंटरेस्ट दैट टेक्स प्लेस इफ एडवाइजर इज अलाउड टू परफॉर्म both the services. So now I hope we are clear with this question and we can move ahead to the next question for today. Okay, here is our third question which says, according to new norms of SEBI, eligibility criteria for registration as an investment advisor includes net worth of rupees dash for non-individuals and rupees dash for individuals. So very simple question, you just have to tell that if there is an individual or a person, or if there is an entity that wants to register with SEBI as an investment advisor, what should be his net worth or its net worth to qualify as an investment advisor? Let's see the correct answer. And the correct answer is option E, 50 lakhs and 5 lakhs. Okay, eligibility criteria for registration, earlier it used to be 25 lakhs for non-individuals, now it has been increased to 50 lakhs, and it used to be 1 lakh for individuals, now it has been increased to 5 lakh. So agar koi entity ya koi individual register karna chahta hai SEBI ke paas as investment advisor, to use ye criteria fulfill karna zaruri hai, uski net worth jo hai wo 50 lakh honi chahiye in case that is an entity, a non-individual, and उसकी नेटवर्थ एटलीस्ट होनी चाहिए 5 लाख इफ ही और शी इज एन इंडिविजुअल, राइट? एंड उसके साथ साथ इनके पास पोस्ट ग्रेजुएट क्वालिफिकेशन भी होनी चाहिए रेलेवेंट सब्जेक्ट्स में, एंड आफ्टर दैट दे शुड हैव एटलीस्ट रेलेवेंट एक्सपीरियंस ऑफ 5 ईयर इन द फील्ड ऑफ इन्वेस्टिंग वाइल ग्रैंडफादरिंग द एग्जिस्टिंग इंडिविजुअल इन्वेस्टमेंट एडवाइजर्स फ्रॉम कंप्लाइंग विद द एनहांस्ड क्वालिफिकेशन एंड एक्सपीरियंस बाय सेबी. सो सेबी सेज that if currently any investment advisor is working and that investment advisor does not fulfill this criteria of postgraduate education and 5 years of experience, nothing is going to happen to that investment advisor, that person can continue working. But the new investment advisors that are going to be registered with SEBI, they should at least have these qualifications, right? And if there is an employee who has to be associated with investment advice, they should also have a postgraduate degree and 2 years of, at least 2 years of experience, right? So as you can see, SEBI has enhanced the criteria. And why do you think SEBI has done this? So till you guys think about this, we are going to discuss the last point, which says individual registered as investment advisors, number of clients if whom they cater to exceed 150 in total shall apply for registration with SEBI as non-individual investment advisor. So an individual who is handling more than 150 client, that advisor would have to register with SEBI as a non-individual investment advisor, as he or she is working at a large scale, right? So these this criteria has been enhanced just to provide more benefit to the client, so that those entities who are posing as investment advisors to the clients, they should be financially secure, they should have a good capital in case they need it, and they should have a relevant educational qualification and experience in their field, right? So basically to bring in professionalism and specialization in investment business, right? Moving ahead for the fourth question for today, which says select the correct statement. Okay, here five statements are given to you regarding interest rates and yield on fixed income securities. You have to select the correct one. And the correct option for this question is solution A. Option A. Option A is the solution. Falling interest rates will lead to lower yield on fixed income securities. So if interest rates are going to fall, they are going to a lower income for all those people who have put their money into fixed income securities like bonds, safer bonds, right? So let us now get some more information regarding this. Though now, as you can see in the current scenario, there has been a trend of risk aversion. अभी करंट के हालात में हर कोई रिस्क अवॉइड करना चाहता है. कोई भी इन्वेस्टर अपना मनी जो है वो रिस्कियर एसेट्स में नहीं डालना चाहता और सेफ एसेट्स में डालना चाहता है. एंड द रिस्क एपेटाइट ऑफ मार्केट इज़ वेरी लो. सो उस वजह से लोग क्या कर रहे हैं कि वो अपना मनी जो है, जितने भी उनकी सेविंग्स हैं, वो उसको चुपचाप बैंक में पार्क कर देते हैं रादर देन इन्वेस्टिंग देम इन शेयर्स और स्टॉक्स और ETFs. Or whatever are the risky investment, they do not want to put their money in there. They want to put their money in safer investments, or they want to park their money with banks as a fixed deposit, right? So they might get lower returns, but at least their money is safe. So currently investors are more concerned about the safety of their money rather than the returns they are getting, right? So that is why banks are seeing an oversupply of funds. So we have also discussed it in one of the previous sessions, in many sessions gradually, that how banks are seeing an oversupply of funds because investors are not investing their money, they are parking their money with banks, and that too creditworthy banks on which they trust. Okay, in this rescue operation, the need of depositors are getting overlooked. Now, as you can see that central banks all over the world, they are on a spree of cutting the interest rate. Central banks sari duniya mein rates ko cut kar rahe hain, interest rates ko, aur wo kyu kar rahe hain? Taki businesses ko cheaper rate par paisa mil sake, aur businesses agar paisa avail karenge, operation karenge, to that will help to kickstart the economy. To usse economy ko ek start mil jayega. राइट. सो सेंट्रल बैंक्स इंटरेस्ट रेट्स तो कट कर रहे हैं ताकि बैंक्स को बेनिफिट हो और बिजनेसेस को बेनिफिट हो, उनको चीपर रेट पे फंडिंग मिले. बट उसकी वजह से जो डिपॉजिटर्स हैं उनको नुकसान हो रहा है. और वो कैसे? सो द डिपॉजिटर्स, लेट्स से देयर इज सम सीनियर सिटीजन मोर देन 65-70 ईयर्स ऑफ एज एंड दे आर डिपेंडेंट ऑन वट एवर इंटरेस्ट दे अर्न फ्रॉम द FD of their money that they have kept in bank, or they have invested their money into some government bonds, whatever interest they get, they survive on that only, right? So with the interest rates falling, the yield on such securities, such safer assets is going to fall. And when it is going to fall, these people dependent upon fixed income investments, who are often senior citizens, they are going to fall short of their required returns. सो अगर कोई सीनियर सिटीजन्स हैं जो सिर्फ फिक्स्ड इनकम सिक्योरिटीज़ पर जीते हैं, उनकी लाइवलीहुड का सिर्फ एक यही जरिया है, तो उनको बहुत प्रॉब्लम होने वाला है, क्योंकि इंटरेस्ट रेट के गिरने से बिजनेसेस को तो फ़ायदा होगा, बट इसकी वजह से जो इंटरेस्ट रेट इन सीनियर सिटीजन्स को अपनी इन्वेस्टमेंट पे मिल रहा था वो भी कम हो जाएगा. और सेफ इन्वेस्टमेंट्स पे ये इंटरेस्ट रेट कम क्यों हो रहा है? फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल, बैंक्स के पास ओवर सप्लाई है फंड्स का, दैट इज व्हाई दे कैन अफोर्ड टू प्रोवाइड अ लोअर रेट टू देयर डिपॉजिटर्स. क्योंकि बैंक्स के पास काफ़ी फंड्स आ रहे हैं, इसलिए बैंक्स अपना इंटरेस्ट रेट कम भी कर सकते हैं ताकि लोग अपना पैसा बैंक्स में डालने की बजाय सेफर एसेट्स में डालें, राइट? और अगर अब ये लोग जो फिक्स्ड इनकम सिक्योरिटीज़ पर डिपेंड करते हैं, इनको फिक्स्ड इनकम सिक्योरिटीज़ से एडिक्वेट रिटर्न्स नहीं मिलेंगे, देन दे विल टर्न टू रिस्कियर एसेट्स इन सर्च ऑफ हायर रिटर्न्स. फिर ऑप्शंस हैं, फिर हो सकता है कि वो रिस्कियर एसेट्स में पैसा डालना शुरू करें, जिससे उनका जो रिस्क एक्सपोजर है वो काफ़ी ज़्यादा बढ़ जाएगा, एंड इन केस ऑफ एनी प्रॉब्लम दे विल नॉट बी एबल टू सस्टेन देमसेल्फ. सो इफ these dependents they turn from fixed income securities to riskier assets that can expose them to higher levels of risks and can be really harmful for them in a bad scenario. And also if they turn from safer investments and they start pulling out their money from banks into riskier assets, then banks funding will also drop. As deposits are a source of funds, so आप जो भी पैसा बैंक में जमा कराते हैं वो उसके लिए सोर्स ऑफ फंड है, और वो उस पैसे को इकट्ठा करके बड़े प्रोजेक्ट्स के लिए लोन देता है. तो अगर हम सब अपना पैसा धीरे धीरे बैंक से निकालना शुरू कर देंगे तो बैंक के पास फंडिंग की कमी हो जाएगी, एंड इट विल नॉट बी एबल टू लेंड लार्ज स्केल प्रोजेक्ट विच आर क्रूशियल फॉर कंट्रीज डेवलपमेंट, राइट? सो आई होप नाउ यू अंडरस्टैंड. सो गाइज, देर इज़ वन मोर थिंग, दैट why interest rates lead to lower yield on fixed income securities, because the yield on this securities is usually linked to the policy rates that RBI or the central banks all over the world determine, right? So whatever interest rate they decide, usually the interest on fixed income securities is linked to them. So if interest rates fall, the yield also falls. Okay, here is your last question for today, a very simple question that says, dash refers to numbers of shares that an investor can buy in one transaction. So there is an investor who wants to buy shares. How many shares can that investor buy in one transaction is said to be C, that is lot size. So a very simple question. Lot size means how many goods can you buy in one transaction. So why are we talking about lot size? Because SEBI is considering to gradually lower the minimum trading lot size of REITs. So guys, we have already studied about REITs in one or two of our previous sessions. What does REIT means? Real Estate Investment Trust, the pool of money or the investment that goes into commercial real estate sector, that puts the money into commercial real estate sector and then derive returns out of them. So now SEBI is thinking that minimum trading lot size, that the number of units of investments that can be bought in one go, SEBI should reduce it from current 50,000 to just a single unit of REIT investment. So let's say if the REIT is valued at rupees 5,000, then an investor, he does not have to spend 50,000 at least, that was the norm earlier, and the investor, if he or she wants, he can buy 5,000 rupee unit only, right? So from 50,000 to the value of a single REIT investment. So SEBI ye kyun karna chahta hai? Minimum trading lot size REITs ka jo pehle 50,000 hua karta tha, ki agar investor ko invest karna hai REITs mein to unhe minimum 50,000 to invest karne hi padenge, but ab jitni ek REIT investment ki value hogi minimum एक सिंगल यूनिट की, जिस तरीके से एक सिंगल शेयर का प्राइस होता है, उसी तरीके से रीट्स इन्वेस्टमेंट की भी एक सिंगल यूनिट होती है, और उस सिंगल यूनिट का जो भी प्राइस होगा उस हिसाब से इन्वेस्टर बाय कर सकता है. दैट मींस दैट इन्वेस्टर कैन बाय इवन वन यूनिट ऑफ रीट इन्वेस्टमेंट इफ दे वॉन्ट टू. सो वाई डस सेबी वॉन्ट टू डू सो? टू बिल्ड अ रीट मार्केट इन इंडिया. So REITs are not very popular in India. We have learned, we have studied about it, we hear about it in newspapers, but investors are still not very familiar with REITs. So SEBI wants that a market should be built for them. So it is going to lead to two benefits. First of all, an alternative investment avenue to investors. इन्वेस्टर्स को इन्वेस्ट करने के लिए एक नया ऑल्टरनेटिव मिल जाएगा एंड इट इज गोइंग टू चैनलाइज हाउस होल्ड इन्वेस्टमेंट इन टू कमर्शियल रियल एस्टेट सेक्टर. सो जो नॉर्मल हाउस होल्ड होते हैं उनके पास यूजली इतनी सारी सेविंग्स नहीं होती कि वो जाके एक कमर्शियल रियल एस्टेट बिल्डिंग खरीद लें. लेट्स से कोई हाउस होल्ड है, क्या उनके पास, डू यू थिंक एक लोअर मिडिल क्लास फैमिली या फिर एक मिडिल क्लास फैमिली, उनके पास इतनी सेविंग्स होगी कि वो कोई ऑफिस या कोई कोई ऐसी रियल एस्टेट खरीदे जिसको वो बाद में किराए पर चढ़ा सकें. सो दे डू नॉट हैव सच अमाउंट ऑफ मनी. बट वॉट रीच डज इज दे पूल अ नंबर ऑफ सच इन्वेस्टर्स एंड देन पुट देयर मनी इन टू कमर्शियल रियल एस्टेट. दे बाय प्रॉपर्टीज एंड देन पुट देम आउट टू रेंट और सेल देम, राइट? सो दे डिराइव रिटर्न्स आउट ऑफ इट. सो चैनलिंग हाउस होल्ड इन्वेस्टमेंट इन टू कमर्शियल रियल एस्टेट विच अ सिंगल हाउस होल्ड इज वेरी स्मॉल टू डू ऑन इट्स ओन. Also, it will provide a source of funding to the real estate sector. So, इससे दो फायदे हुए. एक तो investors को एक नया investment avenue मिल गया और secondly, real estate को भी funding का एक new source मिल गया. So, two benefits, new investment avenues to investors and a source of funding for real estate sector, right? So, now I hope you see how REITs, why SEBI wants to develop a REIT market in India. Although SEBI allowed listing of stock exchanges in 2016, SEBI wants that when there is a developed market in India for REITs, REITs should be traded on stock exchanges just like shares do. जैसे shares की trading होती है वैसे ही REITs की trading भी stock exchanges पर होनी चाहिए. But अब तक सिर्फ एक embassy REIT ही एक ऐसा REIT है जो listed है stock exchanges पर और जिसके investors जो है उसको trade कर सकते हैं, right? So guys, these were the 5 questions for today. I hope you learned something new from this video. And if you did, then don't forget to hit the like button. And before ending the session, I would like to cater to one doubt. So Surekha had asked me to explain one article that came up in Economics Times in which it was told that India may ease regulatory pricing cap on ECBs. So ECBs means external commercial borrowings, right? So in this article, it is said that when Indian companies, they borrow from outside or they borrow from foreign or abroad, there is a certain level of cap placed on how much interest they can pay to their investors. So currently, the pricing cap is 450 basis points over the LIBOR. So whatever is the LIBOR, I hope you are familiar with the term LIBOR. If not, then LIBOR is certainly an interest rate which is used as a global benchmark for deciding different interest rates between different among different transactions. So right, whatever the LIBOR is, I think we might have discussed LIBOR in one or two of our previous sessions. If you want link for it, you can ask in the comments, and if I find that, I'll give it to you, because I'm not sure that whether we have discussed it. I think I'll have to check. So now coming back to LIBOR, so currently the pricing cap is 4.5% or 450 basis points above LIBOR. So if LIBOR is 5%, then 5 plus 4.5, that gives 9.5. That means Indian companies cannot offer more than 9.5 interest rate to the abroad investors when they are trying to raise money from abroad. Now what is happening is India is considering easing this price cap, this 4.5. India is thinking that we should relax it or we should increase it, so that if it will be increased, then it would be easier for companies to borrow. Why? Because they can provide a higher rate of interest that can attract a lot of investors. So it would be easier for them to raise investment if they are allowed to provide a higher interest rate. So why do you think that there would be a cap from Indian companies? So this is because if Indian companies are raising debt from abroad and they are bringing dollars and converting them into Indian rupees and then they are trying to use them in India, that can have a huge exchange rate implication. So if many companies, they raise debt in dollars and then convert them into Indian rupee and then use them, so it is going to have a huge exchange rate implication. So government wants to prevent that. That is why they have put a cap on it. But now they are thinking companies are in severe need of money. They are facing severe liquidity crunch. That is why these norms should be eased, right? Okay, as you can see here, to be sure, a change in upper limits might have exchange rate implications if dollar payments and receipts are bunched together. So a dollar bond or loan is priced after adding a markup over a global benchmark such as the US Treasuries or LIBOR, right? So as I told you, there is a cap on it that they cannot provide more than this interest rate. So local companies that raise dollar bonds convert the benchmark into US Treasuries when they price bonds. So basically this article simply says that we can relax these norms, we can allow the companies to provide a higher interest rate, but that is going to have huge implications for Indian exchange rate and government will have to monitor that, because after that, when the companies are going to repay this loan or make interest payments on this loan, they will have to make them in dollars, and for that they would demand dollars, and when they demand dollars, that is going to put a downward pressure on Indian rupee. So guys, I hope aapko samajh mein aa raha ho ye article mein kya diya hua hai. Isme simply itna diya hai ki Indian companies agar foreign se paisa raise karti hain to ek price cap government ne lagayi hui hai ki wo itna hi interest de sakti hain apne investors ko jo abroad mein invest कर रहे हैं इस इंडियन कंपनी में, राइट सो वो कैप क्यों लगाई गई है, ताकि जब वो डॉलर्स में या फिर फॉरेन करेंसी में मनी रेस करते हैं तो एक्सचेंज रेट को बहुत ज़्यादा नुकसान ना हो. बट नाउ सरकार क्या कह रही है कि हम उसको थोड़ा सा ईजी कर देते हैं, क्योंकि अगर हम इसको ईजी कर देंगे, इस प्राइस कैप को थोड़ा सा और ऊपर कर देंगे, या तो कंपनी ज़्यादा इंटरेस्ट रेट दे पाएंगी अपने इन्वेस्टर्स को, जिसकी वजह से ज़्यादा इन्वेस्टर्स अट्रैक्ट होंगे और कंपनीज के लिए मनी रेज करना आसान हो जाएगा. बट इसका भी एक डाउन साइड है दैट जब ये कंपनीज वापस करेंगी पैसा, इस लोन को रीपे करेंगी या फिर इस लोन पर इंटरेस्ट भरेंगी, तब वो फॉरेन करेंसी को, लेट्स से डॉलर्स को डिमांड करेंगी और उससे इंडियन रुपी पर एक डाउनवर्ड प्रेशर बनेगा या फिर इंडियन रुपी के डेप्रिशिएट होने के चांसेस रहेंगे. सो गवर्नमेंट विल हैव टू लुक आफ्टर दैट. सो दिस इज what is being talked in this article. I hope, Surekha, that now this article is clear to you and this was of help to you. Okay, so guys, this is it for today and I'll see you tomorrow with some other set of information, and I hope you learned something new from this video, and if you did, then don't forget to hit the like button. I'll be back tomorrow, and till then, take care of your health, keep your studies going on, and thank you for being here.